Welcome all to the Calandra Institute's 2001 conference, Italian Borderlands, Restrictions, Breaches, and Encounters. We hope you are enjoying the dynamic, informative papers that we've been having for the past 2 weeks. We have three more days following next week going on. And my name is Joseph Sciorra, and I'm chairing today's panel, Sicily as Mediterranean Borderland. We will take questions after each presenter's respective papers. We ask that you write your questions in the Q&A feature, and I will read them so that everyone can hear them. So our first presenter is Professor LINA INSANA of the University of Pittsburgh, where she teaches post-unification Italian culture, Italian fascism and resistance, Italian-American screen studies, Holocaust literature and film, and translation studies. Professor INSANA is the author of Arduous Tasks, Primo Levi, Translation and the Transmission of Holocaust Testimony, as well as various articles on post-memory in the Italian context and on aspects of Italian-American culture. Her current book in progress is a geocritical cultural history of Sicily entitled Charting the Island, Sicilian Position and Belonging from Unification to the European Union. Professor INSANA's paper is From Micheli to the Baracche, the Polis in Flux and Stasis After the 1908 Earthquake of Messina.
Thank you, Joseph. Thank you so much to the Calandra Institute as well. I'm so happy to have followed most of the panels so far this conference, and I'm delighted to be able to share some of this work with you today. I'm going to share my screen. The earthquake that struck the Straits of Messina at 5:20 a.m. on December 28, 1908, remains one of the most destructive European quakes on record. Documentary photos illustrate the sudden and violent force with which buildings were blown apart, torn open, and leveled to rubble. Something like 90% of the city's buildings were destroyed or rendered too unstable to stand. This scale of destruction could not help but radically reconfigure the urban space's borders. The topography of the terremotata city no longer delineated neighborhoods, nor distinctions between public and private spaces. Even that most ostensibly natural of borders, the shoreline and contours of Messina's interface with the straits that separate it from the peninsula, were shifted in the cataclysmic event. A new porosity was suddenly installed between urban and rural populations as urban survivors unable to escape by sea sought refuge in the city's outlying areas, and rural residents of the province drew closer to the city in an effort to restore cut supply chains, especially those carrying food and other necessities. These blurred lines between urban and rural spaces not only characterized the human presence in them, in other words, who was where, but also the ways in which these spaces were newly practiced by those desperate citizens. The quake is also the deadliest in modern European history. Many estimates put the death toll between Messina, Reggio Calabria, and the outlying areas on both sides of the straits at around 100,000, with Messina's city center bearing the brunt of the quake's effects. The early morning hour, the Christmas holiday, even the performance of an opera the night before in the city, all of these factors explain why so many Messinesi, and even returning emigrants by many accounts, found themselves in the city and fast asleep in their homes at the moment the earthquake began. The devastating effects of the quake were thus felt both in the city's built environment and in its very human composition. That day, before the sun even rose on the city, countless civic leaders, political, business, and cultural elites, and institutional and military commanders were killed, creating a civic void corresponding to Messina's gaping topographical chasms. Oh, excuse me. As we'll see, the dynamic between these two tabulae rasae, the built city and its polis, would set the stage for a drawn-out battle over post-earthquake Messina, By the end of 1909, this earthquake-stricken terrain would be newly characterized by a patchwork of emergency residential structures that were gifted from a variety of stakeholders in Messina's fortunes. Stemming from complex legacies of diaspora, labor migration, and state-sponsored violence against Southern sovereignty. This is the story of how Messina's urban footprint was destroyed, contested, and haphazardly remapped by municipal, national, supranational, and transnational forces. The earthquake created a laboratory for how the nation, its agents, and its stakeholders sought to practice Messina's devastated spaces to control, govern, and rebuild them. In my talk today, I'll try to illustrate that assertion in three ways. First, looking at disaster governance in the immediate aftermath of the quake, attempts to colonize the destroyed city through its built environment, and finally jumping to today, the city in stasis and its notorious Baraccopoli. First, to governance. We'll look at the relationship between the military commander, Francesco Mazza, chosen by the Italian state to oversee the immediate post-earthquake rescue and recovery efforts, and on the other hand, the extra-governmental figure of Giuseppe Micheli. Though the two actually worked closely together and Micheli technically operated under Mazza's command during the state-declared state of siege, their respective ways of practicing the city reveal a fierce battle between national and municipal interests, with Messina's civic fortunes positioned at the battle line between the two. General Francesco Mazza was sent to Messina, I'm gonna skip over that previous slide, was sent to Messina as an agent and guardian of the sovereign Italian nation and its claim to absolute power over the disaster site and its reconstruction. A 69-year-old veteran of Italy's embarrassing defeat at Adua at the time of his assignment, with no experience in peacetime disaster management, Mazza was given the fullest control of the situation by then Prime Minister Giovanni Giolitti. Not only were Giolitti's ears full of the Italian king's stories of widespread and immediate looting and lawlessness in Messina, but he still had fresh memories of extreme measures taken in San Francisco just 2 years prior in 1906. So even before Mazza's departure from Palermo, Giolitti authorized a state of siege for Messina that would go into effect on January 4th. This had been a common state response for political unrest in Sicily, but was used here for the first time in a natural disaster context, since the legal apparatus at the time lacked the tools to declare a more appropriate state of emergency. Mazza was delayed by both the flu and logistical obstacles in his attempts to reach the Sicilian city, the disaster city, Messina. But along the way, images of total lawlessness and chaos were reinforced over and over again by military and news dispatches. By the time he finally arrived in the city, Messina's mayor, Gaetano D'Arrigo, had been removed from office after having been accused by the king of having abandoned his post in the first 24 hours of the disaster. Mazza, armed with full powers granted by the state of siege, then made the extraordinary decision to disband entirely Messina's city council, a decision that was never made across the straits in the equally distressed city of Reggio Calabria. Mazza governed the destroyed city for about 7 weeks with an ironclad but very distant fist. Russian and English naval forces, already surveilling the island of Sicily at the time the earthquake hit, had done the lion's share of initial rescue work. So Mazza's first priority, by most accounts, was to have his soldiers secure Messina's financial assets and create a hard perimeter around the city. This was enforced on threat of summary execution to keep unruly and desperate, and therefore criminal, rurals from flooding into the city. Imagined borders separating urban and non-urban or municipal and rural spaces came to stand in for a host of distinctions and boundaries that administratively valid as they may have been before the earthquake were simply not meaningful in a landscape where built environments and civic structures alike had been all but obliterated. Nonetheless, these boundaries determined for Mazza who was allowed to occupy certain spaces and who was instead assumed to be dangerously out of place. Mazza was also extremely anxious to block alleged looters from accessing the valuables buried under the rubble of what had been prime oceanfront residential and commercial real estate. Mazza's tactics were extreme, even cutting off emergency rations distribution in the city to lure reluctant survivors to ships waiting in the straits to transport them away without their knowing it. As Mazza wrote in his official report, these people couldn't possibly have been looking for their own valuables. They clearly weren't the kind of people who had any. As he wrote, given the exceedingly low class of those individuals, the suspicion arose that their reluctance to leave was due to the attraction of enormous quantities of valuables buried under the rubble. And they certainly didn't belong there, close quote. The possibility that they might be looking for loved ones to mourn and properly bury isn't even mentioned in the report. Mazza's profiling of survivors as looters reflected a way of policing and practicing the earthquake zone that surveilled and enforced the city's boundaries with an expectation of criminality, instead of doing the work of rescue and recovery that one might expect from such a state-sponsored force. Adding insult to injury was the fact that Mazza quickly and permanently established his administrative headquarters on the Duca di Genova warship, docked in the straits, very rarely venturing off of his fairly comfortably outfitted vessel to go into the disaster zone. The Italian state's approach to the problems created by the earthquake might be best summarized in its plan, overridden eventually by local and other municipal figures, to raise the city to the ground and simply start over further south down the Sicilian coastline. By treating Messina's urban footprint as a space to be occupied and controlled through martial law, not rescuing and aiding its citizens, but suspending its civic functions and foreclosing the possibility that mourning Messinesi might access their own city, Mazza's 7 weeks of rule breached the polis over and over again. His main legacy in the city seems to be the expression, non capire una mazza, an insult leveled against a person who doesn't understand a thing. Instead, it was a young banker and parliamentarian from Parma named Giuseppe Micheli who improbably earned himself a place in Messina's spatial memory. It is not only his name that is inscribed in the memory of the so-called Michelopoli area of administrative offices and makeshift residences that occupied Viale San Martino. It is also the very specific way that he interacted with both the urban and civic landscapes of the destroyed city. Micheli, who arrived in Messina before Mazza, did so as an emissary of a number of superimposed institutional structures. Parma's intertwined banking and insurance agencies, the Catholic Church, the municipal body of Parma, and a strong network of municipal governments all around Italy. As such, his work was fully reflective of his role as an agent of counter-national forces, quietly challenging the hard rule of Giolitti's and Mazza's state of siege, which saw Messina as a space to be surveilled, contained, mined for resources, and ultimately razed. Instead, Micheli and the institutions he represented were claiming different forms of sovereignty, agency, and governance. Micheli operated within Messina's post-earthquake landscape in a time frame very similar to that of Mazza, and that's what I was trying to show on that slide that I skipped over quickly. And in fact, there are many indications that he saw his work there as a kind of corrective to the state of siege that Mazza represented. While Mazza was still establishing his position in the straits on the Duca di Genova, Micheli immediately commandeered enough wood waste to build barracks, the nucleus of the Michelopoli that would serve as the administrative heart of the rebuilt city. While some in Italian government proposed raising and moving the city, Micheli's insistent and efficient presence in a burgeoning bureaucratic hub in the middle of Viale San Martino, sent the clear message that there was life in the city that could not be simply plowed over. If the administrative Baracche signaled that the polis was alive in its administrative functioning, Micheli also ensured that the city's citizens had access to its destroyed spaces for the recovery of relatives' remains and belongings, thanks to a permit system that he personally lobbied to Mazza to institute and administer. And I've shown you an image of one of those permits from the archive. Perhaps most remarkably, nestled among the more essential baracche was a print shop, outfitted with a press recovered from destroyed military facilities. Out of this makeshift outfit, Micheli published 16 issues of a bulletin newspaper entitled Ordini e Notizie, reflecting its hybrid purpose of conveying both the orders of the sovereign national state and the civic news, the notizie, of a city that was budding back to life. The newspaper ostensibly functioned as a one-way vehicle for messaging to the people of Messina by transmitting Mazza's bandi, or announcements, for the sake of public order, as well as communicating with soldiers and volunteers present in the city through official maps and district descriptions that were published there. But alongside this, it had a much more civic function that eventually published letters to the editor, growing lists of business establishments, getting back on their feet, and even back page business ads, as you can see in this slide. But Ordini e Notizie makes its strongest interventions into rebuilding the polis when it begins to publish near the end of its run in mid-February, items by Micheli and other leaders of the National Association of Italian Municipalities, or ANCI. In these, we see them actively lobbying for the reinstatement of Messina's Consiglio Comunale, their city council, so that the state of siege could be ended and government returned to municipal sovereignty. On the front page of one remarkable issue published on February 13th, 1909, Mazza's voice, Micheli's voice, and the Italian king's voice are all staged in a civic dialogue, regarding Messina's future and its sovereignty in the form of statements and decrees that emanated from different days, places, and political positions. The result is a civic performance by the newspaper that reshapes the new boundaries of Messina's civic life, wresting back municipal control for its affairs from the state of siege proclaimed by the state 7 weeks before. In a fascinating sleight of journalistic hand, the civic dialogue staged in Micheli's bulletin seems to be conjuring the end of martial law, which in fact goes into effect the next day, even though it had been signed into effect weeks before. The state's poorly managed response to the Messina disaster set up a battle between national and municipal forces over who would control the city's spaces and how. But looking at post-quake Messina from another perspective, we can see beyond how those contending for sovereignty inhabited the city borders. Specifically, we can also identify in Messina's rebuilt environment the ways that Messina was already a contended space before the 1908 disaster and the transnational forces of migration and labor that made it so. This haphazard patchwork of housing set into motion a cycle of shantytown after shantytown, responding to urgent natural, humanitarian, and political needs. The earthquake, fascist infrastructure plans, World War II bombings, and political promises ever since. My talk, after we talk about a few of those things, will finally conclude with a few reflections on the stasis of this eternal baraccopoli in Messina. The small cluster of administrative and residential structures that made up Michelopoli would soon give way to other sections of built environment where the historic port city of Messina had once featured theaters, Baroque churches, and an elegant palazzata marking the border between land and sea. Over the course of the next year and the temporal space between the state of siege and the Piano Borzi that would eventually shape Messina's permanent reconstruction, a number of national and transnational entities sent reconstruction aid to the destroyed city in the form of lumber, housing plans, engineering expertise, and even prefab residential structures. The result was a quilt of villages and neighborhoods that projected American, Danish, Swiss, and other vistas onto the recently leveled Sicilian terrain and embedded the architectural styles of hegemonic Italian national spaces, such as the wealthy economic capital of Lombardy and even the Italian monarchy. These villages' appearance during the early phases of Messina's reconstruction is attributable to a variety of historical factors and transnational dynamics. For the purpose of brevity, I'll focus on one factor, labor emigration, and one of its dynamics, Sicilian labor communities in Switzerland, as an example of the complicated border crossing that shaped Messina's evolving urban footprint after the earthquake. Luigi Einaudi, writing in the Nuova Antologia in 1900, described an exploding construction and infrastructure boom all over Europe, fueled by mobile Italian labor, particularly in Switzerland, where many Italians in the building trades had been attracted by major infrastructure projects. So it was, quote, so it was with the Gottardo Tunnel and its rail line, so it is now, in 1900, with the Sempione Tunnel, unquote. The Sempione project in particular had attracted large communities of Sicilian and Calabrese workers to the region and so created a mining district that linked sulfur mining communities in the deep south to tunnel mining in the Alpine border regions. As the historian Giovanna Meyer Sabino writes, quote, unlike the mostly northern Italian labor used for the Gottardo, it was Calabrese and Sicilian as well as Romagnolo labor that was recruited for the Sempione project, because it was thought that those workers could better withstand the very high temperatures in the tunnel. The Swiss government and the Swiss Red Cross, upon hearing of the disaster in the Straits, immediately set about to raise an unprecedented sum of money and to send supplies and volunteers to the disaster site in the Red Cross's first peacetime disaster relief effort. According to historian Pietro Wellnofer, the scale of this effort was a direct result of the labor migration connection between the two regions. Interestingly, the Swiss contributions were not donated directly to the Italian government, nor did the Swiss respect stated Italian guidelines for the transportation of donated materials. Instead, the Swiss breached the bureaucratic guardrails that the Italian government had put into place in the hopes of controlling the post-earthquake architectural and political landscapes. They sent their human and material resources via rail through Alpine tunnels, flouting Italian orders to deliver them by sea routes. The Red Cross installed its own planners, architects, and even carpenters to survey and claim the land it wanted, to design the structures and to build them using their own hydraulic and sewage system plans. Further, they insisted on setting strict labor and financial terms for these structures. Red Cross leadership made legal provisions to prohibit piecework and discourage speculation on the properties by grouping them all into a Swiss zone and entrusting them to a legally established foundation. According to Wellnofer, the resulting homes were modeled on the typical residential structures of Bern, Switzerland, which the main Swiss figures called home. The legacies of Messina's pre-earthquake labor migrations then were a factor in the contours of the post-earthquake urban plan, as destination nations repaid Italy's labor debt by projecting their own native built environments onto the southern Italian landscape. No, let me skip that. There we go. The more or less temporary housing that resulted from these transnational projections would form the nucleus of Messina's current day Baraccopoli. And I'm concluding now, or shanty towns. Evolving and changing through the grandi opere, the great works of fascism, the Allied bombings of World War II, post-war reconstruction, and years of more recent proposals and counter-proposals from city leadership. Endless debates over whether any of the present shantytown structures actually date from 1908 have ossified into glacially paced initiatives to move the residents of blighted areas into proper public housing. Nonetheless, the shantytowns remain, blighted spaces within the city of Messina and a constant reminder of the ways that the city's borders have been violently reshaped by both natural and man-made phenomena. Paradoxically, the end result of this long evolution is an environment now characterized by a paralyzing stasis, an unyielding local bureaucracy, crushing social immobility, and temporary, in quotes, structures that seem to have become permanent long ago. As a result, these slum spaces have come to live under the Italian public's scandalized gaze, the perfect fodder for Italy's expose culture machine. This has had the effect of both solidifying the space's image as Messina's eternal problem and breaching the visual borders of those spaces, rendering them increasingly porous and making their residents' lives voyeuristically accessible to those on the outside. One such television expose, airing just after the earthquake's 100th anniversary, also revealed yet another characteristic of the Baraccopoli. They are, it seems, what Teresa Fiore has called preoccupied spaces, formed through the processes of displacement, and the South's perpetual marginalization, further reinforced by Sicily's islandness. These areas have been inhabited by generations of subalterns who are now caught within the borders of a Baraccopoli within a polis, a city within a city. In their own vision of their status, fed by a feedback loop of media coverage of migrant tendopoli or tent cities that conflates living conditions, configurations of cultural belonging and legal status, they are, quote, worse off than the extra comunitari. Others and outsiders in their own city, in their own country, they attribute to themselves the status of stateless, homeless subjects without the benefits that legal citizenship and national belonging should bring. I have a clip that I will skip, but you can see the quote underneath the video block. The interviewed woman who has lived in the shantytown for generations says, worse than illegal immigrants, in Italy, the interviewer says, and she says, yes, Italians, we're illegal Italians. In conclusion, these Baraccopoli and their trapped residents stand as the earthquake's legacy. The historian John Dickey has wondered in a short documentary film and an unpublished essay whether the disaster left Messina, the earthquake that is, left Messina as a city without memory. But these spaces are in fact very visible and tangible spatial memorializations of Messina's state of exception from the law, from belonging, from sovereignty that extends from the Italian state's initial response to the earthquake and perhaps before, but whose barriers to mobility and social change grow ever more rigid today. Their continued presence in the city's landscape should compel us to examine not only solutions to this troubling stasis, but also its deep historical connections to fierce battles over national and municipal sovereignty, to legacies of labor emigration, and to Sicily's complicated islandness and border status at the edge of empire, nation, and indeed the European Union. Thank you.
Thank you, Lina. We have three questions so far from an anonymous attendee. Do you know or have any sense of why Giuliotti might have picked Maza for this mission?
It's a great question. He was located in the region. He was nominally in charge of the region, and had a certain degree of seniority. And Giuliotti was desperate to get military feet on the ground, and needed a kind of military presence to control the space based on what the king had told Giuliotti. It's important to note that Giuliotti never went to visit the earthquake site. The king was there and gone with the queen by the time the state of siege was declared. And it was in fact the state, it was those stories that were circulating already about lawlessness and looting that caused the state of siege and Mazza's appointment to be made.
Our second question comes from Donna Gabacha, who asks, could you say a bit more about the architectural features that represented the Swissness of the Swiss buildings, the Americanness of the American ones, et cetera?
The Swiss case is really interesting because if you go to, a lot of this information is publicly available on the Swiss Red Cross website, as are lots of great interviews with the historian that I mentioned. There's a great gallery of photos, in addition to the photos and materials that are available in archives in Messina and in Parma. The Swiss case is particularly interesting because of the really close, intensive engagement that the Swiss government and the Swiss Red Cross had with the process of shipping and building these structures. They were designed to look like and to be like Swiss chalet, of the kind that you would see in Bern. And they were grouped together in a neighborhood, as most of these national projections were. The American structures were shipped partially prefabbed across the Atlantic. The American case is a really interesting one too that I didn't really have time to get into, but it's well documented, not only by historians, but by many of the military folks who were involved in that aid and relief and delivery effort. And they look very much like American, American homes of the 10s and 20s, right? They're very simple and they're very uniform. The Swiss chalets are much more ornate and much more kind of instinctively Swiss, right? Alpine. They look like ski lodges in the middle of Messina.
Chris Rominger asks, how did the international community view the Italian government's response to the disaster? Did foreign aid delivered by warships and the sensationalist press coverage reflect and or contribute to the atmosphere of imperial competence and violence in the Mediterranean? Imperial competition and violence in the Mediterranean.
The short answer is yes. And to fully answer the question, I have to place the earthquake in 1908 in a broader political and geopolitical context, because as I briefly mentioned in the talk, Russian and English warships were already regularly surveilling the Sicilian coast because the south of Italy was seen as particularly vulnerable, even within an Italy that was seen as vulnerable within the European context, within a colonial context. And so there were whispers of coming conflict. And for many, in the days and weeks after the earthquake, the eyes that were on Italy and on the south of Italy and on the way that the Italian state responded to the earthquake were on them precisely because it was seen as a dry run for war. It was seen as a response that in this case was a disaster response, but that would tell the world a lot about how Italy might respond should there be a breakout of war in the Mediterranean. So the earthquake was really intimately tied to these larger geopolitical and military questions. John Dickey has written about this in his book, A Patriotic Disaster, and some really excellent Italian historians have written about it as well.
Victoria Sferlaza asked, can you comment on immigration from Messina to the US at the time?
I can't. This is actually, this is a blind spot of mine, so to speak. I haven't been able to find a lot of work done either on preceding emigration patterns specifically from that corner of Sicily to the US, nor have I been able to find a lot of work done, solid historical work on the on the evacuation efforts and to what extent they led to Messinese coming to the United States or North America or anywhere in particular at all. So I'm sorry, this is a question that I've asked myself a lot in the course of this project, this research, and I haven't been able to come up with clear answers. If anyone here has those answers, I would love to hear them.
Carla Ash asks, was there no shantytown area before the earthquake where the poorest citizens lived?
Not a shantytown, certainly not. The previous major catastrophic earthquake, which had happened, you know, more than a century before the 1908 earthquake, resulted in some serious reforms in meaningful reconstruction that was somewhat safer than previous structures had been. So even though it is certainly an area that is very seismically active, you didn't have remnants of this very modern kind, right? The shantytown is a kind of modern vestige, right? You didn't have that before the Messina earthquake, no.
From an anonymous attendee who asks, to clarify, are the colored shapes on the map of Messina the various baraccopoli?
Yeah, thank you for asking that question. I wanted to not go on too long. That last slide contains an image that is basically a screenshot that I'm so happy that I took when I took it. It's a screenshot of a project that was undertaken by the Political Science Department at the University of Messina that mapped out every structure and every neighborhood within the city of Messina that could be called a shantytown or a baraccopoli. And unfortunately, that Google map has seen, just in the last time I checked for it a week or so ago, has disappeared. But that's what that is. That's a visualization of where the shanty neighborhoods are in Messina.
Francesca Saltman asks, can you say anything about Reggio? Was it treated better, that is, with more acknowledgement of municipal sovereignty and regional culture?
To the extent that the city council of Reggio was not ever suspended or disbanded in the way that Messina's was, yes, it was treated better. There seems to have been a more consistent recognition that Reggiani could manage their own affairs. And because of perceptions of the incompetence and the ineptitude of Messina's mayor in the first day after the earthquake hit, Messina was not treated in the same way, and their city council was disbanded. Now, a great number of that city council members had been killed in the quake. And so there were other reasons. It wasn't, I don't want to scapegoat the mayor. There were other reasons as well, but there were perceptions of Sicilian lawlessness that I think contributed to that treatment.
And our final question, were the immigration and other important records lost in the earthquake?
A lot of records were lost. A lot were saved and transported offsite for safety. There does seem to have been great attention to the safety of documents, the safety of records, as I mentioned, the safety of valuables in banks, in public venues, et cetera. So a good number of records do survive. Municipal records, and remarkably, within days of building those barracks on Viale San Martino, Giuseppe Micheli was able to open a death and birth records office. So immediately, those offices were restarted by Micheli himself.
Great. Thank you, Lina. Thank you so much for that presentation.
Thank you. Thank you for your questions.
Our next presenter is Giuliano Fleri, who holds an MA in philosophy from the University of Catania and is currently a PhD candidate in international history at the Graduate Institute of Geneva. He was a research assistant for the Archives and Records Division of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. His paper is The Rebirth of a Mediterranean Migration System, Migration Between Sicily and Tunisia. Giuliano?
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you for organizing this wonderful conference. So I'm sharing my screen. Let me see if you can see it. Is it okay?
Yes, we can see it.
Perfect. So today I'm going to talk about part of my research, the research I'm conducting for my PhD at the Graduate Institute of International and Development Studies, concerning movements between Tunisia and Sicily. So I'm trying to connect older patterns of movement in the Channel of Sicily with more recent migration in the Mediterranean. So according to the UNHCR, between January and October 2020, despite the coronavirus, more than 34,000 migrants arrived in Italy by sea. The overwhelming majority of these arrivals was in Sicily, between the island of Lampedusa and the southern shores of Sicily itself. As we all know, because of the informal and irregular trips are organized, these journeys have often turned into terrible tragedies. Despite the number of deaths in the central Mediterranean dropped if compared with the previous period between 2014 and 2017 at the peak of the so-called European migration crisis, hundreds of people continue to lose their lives in the Mediterranean in the attempt to reach the European shores. According to the International Organization for Migration, in the first 3 months of 2021, so between January and March of this year, already 234 people have died in the Channel of Sicily, keeping this stretch of sea the deadliest border in the world. So while we are getting sadly used to this kind of headlines, the public debate, at least in Italy, still focuses on the debate and opposition between humanitarian approaches and securitarian ones. The collision absorbs so much the attention of the public opinion that I think we are losing sight of some fundamental questions. The discussion and the revolving debate revolves around words and buzzwords like economic migrants, humanitarian action, humanitarianism, and in this public interpretation, poverty, war, or hunger are seen as drivers that push people to accept the fatal risk of Mediterranean crossing to reach a refuge in Europe. But for my research, I asked myself if this is the only account that we can have, and if there are other drivers beyond these ones, and if there are a deeper connection between destination and origin areas. In my research, I propose to overcome the study of Mediterranean migration as a unique, univocal phenomenon. And instead, I propose to go beyond labels and I propose to break down Mediterranean migration in various strands that compose it. And my case study in particular focuses on the central Mediterranean route and on the corridor connecting Sicily and Tunisia. So in 2020, between January and October, these are the data from the UNHCR. Tunisia and Tunisians played a major role with 41% of the people coming to Sicily being Tunisians, actually, and 45% of the ships left from the Tunisian coasts. This is already an interesting starting point to go beyond popular interpretation, because even if Tunisia is not an affluent state and is living a difficult moment, is not a state that is experiencing a war situation or questions of hunger or state collapse. What is even more interesting for historians is that unlike other national groups like Syrian, Afghans, Pakistani, these people, Tunisians, have a strong story of relationship with the destination area, with Sicily. A Tunisian arriving in Sicily is not an alien that comes into a foreign world. There are the presence of Tunisian communities is a structural element of contemporary Sicilian society, an element that stems from a long story of migration, especially between the southern shores of the southwestern shore of the island and the coastal part of Tunisia. So this long story of exchange and encounters today translate in the presence of nearly 21,000 Tunisians, and they make up the second foreign community of the island behind Romanians and represent more than 10% of the island foreign population. As we can see from this map, actually Sicily is not a very common popular destination for international migrants, but it is for Tunisian nationals. In fact, the provincia di Ragusa and provincia di Trapani are among the most important province for Tunisian immigration in Italy. So despite the attitude of the public opinion that focuses always on the present and often links Tunisian migration to Sicily to the latest events, the latest often tragic events, the beginning of Tunisian migration to or through Sicily dates back of several decades, actually. So I think that this specific case study of Tunisians in Sicily help us to give historical depth to the current migration patterns in the Mediterranean, and shed also a light on the various phases of European migration policies. So the question about Tunisian migration is, if did not start recently, when did it start? So we have a small literature about this argument. Here I put a couple of the most important books. Ascens Lama was an historian coming from the Tunisian community of Sicily himself, and he wrote this book in 1980. Antonino Cosumano wrote about the immigration of Tunisians in Western Sicily in 1978, and then we have two more recent contributes from Naor Ben Yoyada and from Michele Corucci. But I wanted to go back to primary sources to see the first documentary proof about the emergence of this migration flow. And what I found was this. Ministry of the Interior received in April 1971 a letter signed by the unions of Castelvetrano, a small rural village in the southwestern part of Sicily. This letter is held at the Archivio Centrale dello Stato in Roma. In this letter, the unions noted that the Tunisian presence was becoming, in March 1971, a phenomenon bigger and bigger day after day. So through this letter, the unions, for the first time, drew the attention of the government to the phenomenon of Tunisian migration in the provincia di Trapani. And it was one of the very first cases in which central authorities had to deal with a case of international labor migration. The union's complaints prompted the Ministry of the Interior and the Ministry of Labor, Ministro del Lavoro, to verify the actual extent of the phenomenon on the territory. The two ministeri drew the attention of their territorial offices, la Prefettura, la Questura, e l'Ispettorato del Lavoro, to shed light on what was happening there. And almost immediately, it became obvious that the unions were right. Migrants were not confined to Castelvetrano, but Tunisian migration touched all the provincia di Trapani, and especially the area around Trapani, Marsala, and in particular the coastal town of Mazara del Vallo. The authorities estimated that Tunisian communities in Western Sicily counted more or less 2,000 units, and this number was growing gradually. So despite the difficulties of this investigation, the survey gradually took on an increasingly important dimension, requiring the participation first of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and then of Tunisian diplomatic authorities. So from this document, it's possible to deduce, because after the investigation, these documents coming from the investigation are held together now in a fund, the Archivio Centrale dello Stato. From this document, we can deduce two particularly interesting and revealing elements of the original characteristic and dynamics implicit in these settlements of Tunisian workers. The first element concerns concerns the opposite attitude of the Ministry of the Interior and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in relation to the phenomenon. In this photo, we have on the left, Franco Restivo, Minister of the Interior back then, and on the right, Aldo Moro, Minister of Foreign Affairs. So the Minister of the Interior and its offices, since the report made by the unions, implemented an action aimed at reducing the phenomenon through measures such as repatriation and refoulements of new arrivals. The Minister of the Interior acted with an exclusive attention towards the law regulating the stay of foreigners and concerns about public order. On the contrary, the Minister of Foreign Affairs, as soon as called into question, pointed out to all the competent bodies and to other ministries that the issue of Tunisian immigration in Trapani involved dynamics that went beyond public order and mobilized question of international relations. So the representative of the Foreign Affairs lobbied for an extraordinary regularization for Tunisian migrants as the most suitable solution to avoid any type of conflict. And to justify this position, they pointed out the fact that in 1971, still 2,000 Italians resided in Tunisia against a population of about 2,000 Tunisians in Western Sicily. So any reckless action could have endangered not only the relation between the two states, but also the conditions of these Italians who were still residing in Tunisia. Moreover, Italy saw Tunisia as a strategic ally in its energy policy, especially with Libya and Algeria. Indeed, in that very moment, in the early 70s, Eni, which is the Italian multinational oil and gas company, was testing the feasibility of the gas pipeline connecting Algeria to Sicily through Tunisia. And so it was extremely important to have good relationship with Tunisia to carry on this project of the Trans-Mediterranean pipeline, today called Mattei pipeline. So thanks to this argument, the opinion of Foreign Affairs prevailed, and despite initial rejection and repatriation, a different approach was adopted. Refoulement measures were stopped, and in 1973, a very interesting, historically interesting regularization was issued. It was a regularization just for Tunisian nationals, just in one region, in Sicily. So from that moment on, and throughout the rest of the 70s and the 80s, authorities tolerated the presence of Tunisian workers in Sicily, even if they were not 100% regular. A second revealing element emerged from the internal correspondence of the Ministry of Labor, il Ministero del Lavoro. As mentioned, the coastal town of Mazara del Vallo hosted almost half of the foreign workforce present in the provincia. The Mazara del Vallo fleet was experiencing at the turn of the 60s and the 70s a moment of great expansion that would have led it later, in the 80s, to become the largest fishing fleet in the Mediterranean. This development was due, at least in part, to the constant flows of resources from central development program, especially from the Cassa del Mezzogiorno, which financed the motorization of fishing vessels. So Mazara del Vallo fishing activities represented one of the few growing sectors in an area which was otherwise economically depressed. So the Ministero del Lavoro asked itself how it was possible that in an area so economically depressed, ship owners were preferring Tunisian workers over Sicilian workers. According to the investigation carried out by the Ministero del Lavoro itself, the presence of a significant number of Tunisians in the Mazarese fleet was not linked to an absence of local labor, but to an internal need of the fleet operations itself. The offshore fishing methods practiced by the Mazaresi vessels and the geographical distribution of the fish fauna in the Sicilian Channel contributed to the enlargement of fishing operations well beyond Italian territorial waters, pushing the activities toward the Tunisian coasts. In this map, we can see the border of national waters, and here in green we have this area called the Mamelone, an important area of fauna reproduction. So the Mazaresi vessels wanted to expand their operation towards this area and towards the Tunisian coast and this area around the Kerkena Islands. This ambitious plan of the ship owners, of the class of the Mazaresi ship owners, convincing them to hire Tunisian personnel in the belief that this presence could represent a sort of permission for Sicilian boats in Tunisian territorial waters. According to people I interviewed in Mazara del Vallo, Tunisian and Sicilians alike, a tacit agreement between Mazarese owners and Tunisian authorities allowed the Italian boats to operate in Tunisian waters. So we had, from one side, a dimension of international relation represented by the concern of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. From the other, we have a network of transnational connection created by the Mazarese fleet, which contribute to link the two sides of the channel. In this context, Sicilian trawlers and their operations went beyond not only national geographical borders, but also national institutional borders, moving beyond spaces and making a transnational network of labor. So while Italian presence and economic interests in Tunisia made it impossible for Italian authorities to refuel Tunisian workers, even irregular ones, the expansion of the Mazarese fleet created a circle of mutual strengthening between economic activities and immigration. Nevertheless, Sicilian ship owners did not recruit Tunisian workers in Tunisia, but they relied on small groups of Tunisians already present in the island and on their personal network. Tunisians that were present in Tunisia in Sicily before the 1970s. And here we have the third and key element in the emergence of a Tunisian migration towards Sicily, namely the historical ties created by Sicilian emigrations towards Tunisia. So as we know, Tunisia was a French colony from 1881 to 1956, but for most of this time, Italians were the larger European population, and Sicilians represented around 70 or 80% of the Italian communities. So we can estimate that at its peak in the 1930s, there were around 70,000 persons of Sicilian origin or were actually born in Sicily. Then the Second World War first and Tunisian independence then in 56 brought about a progressive disintegration of these communities. The Arabization of Tunisia between 56 and 64 dissolved the basis for an Italian and Sicilian presence in Tunisia. But through the documents that I found at the Archivio di Stato di Trapani and l'Archivio delle Memorie Italiane di Tunisia in Tunis, I was able to reconstruct, at least in part, these return flows of Sicilian Tunisians toward Europe. Obviously, after 64, the communities fragmented. Many left for France. Others continued their migration towards other countries like Switzerland or Germany. Those who did not have enough resources were hosted in refugees camps in Italy, in Latina, Brindisi, Tortona, and so on and so forth. But a part of this community went back to its land of origin, to the town in western Sicily, the very same town we have seen at the beginning. And it was this movement that brought the first Tunisians to Sicily. Ties resulting from years of coexistence, from working relationship, from family ties, determined the movement of the first Tunisians to the province of Trapani. As early as the first proof that I found was as early as 1963, so almost a decade before the letter, the complaint of the unions in Castelvetrano. So we have an old migration system that had brought between the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, tens of thousands of Sicilians in Tunisia that turned direction and gives birth or rebirth to the modern migration system between Tunisia and Sicily. So through this rapid account of movements between Tunisia and Sicily, we see that behind the rhetoric of an immigrant invasion that we are experiencing right now, there are much more nuanced stories of contacts, encounters, transnational connection that go on since the beginning of the 20th century and cross colonial, post-colonial, and more recent patterns of Mediterranean mobility. The pivotal moment changing the history, at least the recent history of Tunisian migration towards Sicily was 1990, when on the road toward the creation of the Schengen area, Italy imposed visa requirements to Maghreb states, including Tunisia. Schengen obviously changed the meaning of the transnational ties between Tunisia and Sicily and the history of international relationship between the Tunisian and the Italian state. From that moment on, reaching Sicily became harder and harder. But nevertheless, the maritime network that has been in place for decades and the importance of the fishing fleet in this migration system made irregular crossing on trawlers, what the press called today ghost landings or approdi fantasma, that has become a common practice among Tunisians wanting to reach not only Sicily, but the whole of Europe. So I want to stress a couple of points that I think are interesting in this analysis of migration between Sicily and Tunisia. So a historical approach on Mediterranean migration, I think, invite us to consider the precedent of what is considered an unprecedented era of migration. Looking at history give us the depth of this story. And I think instead we should shift our attention from the emergency as a category to describe what is happening in the Mediterranean, and look with more attention at transnational and international connection between origin and destination areas. I think we need to normalize our vision of migration, especially at least in Italy, and stop seeing the movement of people as a humanitarian crisis in itself. Because as we have seen, movements of people in this area is a pretty normal thing. What is normal instead is the mechanism that prevents these Mediterranean mobilities and the consequences that are often been very tragic. And thank you.
Thank you, Giuliano. And we have some questions here already. So we go to Donna Gabacha, who asks, the relationship of fishing work and Tunisian migration is obvious and strong, yet the first complaint came from the labor movement of Castelvetrano. Do you know what work they were doing there? Castelvetrano is a center of olive production and processing.
Exactly. They were working in agriculture, and most of them, it was interesting because actually these Tunisians that worked in the province of Trapani, and still now there is a bit this categorization, there is a division between those who works in the seafaring activities and those who work in Campania. And they are, most of them are seasonal workers that go back and forth from Tunisia to Sicily. And they work in the vineyards, in olive production, all kind of agricultural production of that area.
I have a question. Given the historical migration flows between Sicily and Tunisia, what has been the Sicilians' response to Tunisian migration into the island? Is there a sense of affinity because of that historical migration? And do they see Tunisian immigrants different from, say, other non-Tunisian immigrants coming to the island?
I think there is a difference because of actually the size of the community itself, but I don't think it comes from the historical recognition of the fact that we have been migrants there, so we are welcoming you here. I don't see this. I see that there are strong relationships because it's actually the oldest foreign community in Sicily, but otherwise I don't see other kind of dynamics, the recognition of colonial or post-colonial relations. I cannot hear you.
Neither can anybody else.
Yeah.
Now they can. Were there any Tunisian/Sicilian activity in Malta?
Is there any Tunisian/Sicilian activity in Malta? That's something I couldn't say for sure. I mean, I'm sure that Malta is like a crossroad island in the Mediterranean, and it is a mixture, a point of encountering between Sicilian and Tunisian. It has been like that since the 19th century, at least. And I also know that Tunisia was a place in which Sicilian and Maltese met and often created family ties between them, Maltese that became Italians through marriage. Concerning migration, I've not concerning this pattern of movement that brought workers from Tunisia to Sicily, I don't see like crossroads with Malta.
Robert Opedisano asks, I've read that the Tunisian fishing community in Shaka has become central to the industry there, moving from seasonal laborers to wholesalers, merchants, fleet owners, and others with a real local economic presence. Is this also true more generally in Mazara and elsewhere? And what might this apparent economic position say about social and cultural integration of future Tunisian generations and families?
Yeah, the answer is yes. We have, obviously, there is always a question of being Tunisian in Sicily. You are always in the position of the immigrant. So you are starting from a lower level, I would say, culturally, socially. But there are cases also in Mazara del Vallo in which Tunisians are now owners, ship owners. They have their own industries. And this is growing. Indeed, is very, very interesting to visit. I come from the other part of the island, and it's very interesting to see cases as Shaka, Mazara del Vallo, and Marsala, in which you have really collaboration between these communities, and you can see that Tunisians are growing, are being able, now they have spaces for economic development to build their own economic activities. And sorry, I didn't catch the last part. What was I saying about social and cultural integration of Tunisia and families? No, I have to say that, and that's why it struck me when I was in Mazara del Vallo for my field study, the fact that already the second, third generations of Tunisians living in Mazara del Vallo, they are 100%, they have these mixed allegiances between Italy and Tunisia, but they are doing well and they are accepted by Mazaresi. And obviously there were decades of struggle between them, but now the situation is definitely improving and is an example of coexistence, which is not that easy to find in Sicily.
Anthony Sargenti says, I have also stumbled upon the year 1990 as the beginning of quote unquote unprecedented emigration. In your view, did the new visa requirements cause this quote unquote change? And could a lot of media and scholarship be confusing cause and effect?
That's a very interesting question. From what I've seen, I do consider the imposition of visa requirements as a watershed, and it was, yes, at least for what I've studied, it was the cause of what happened afterwards, because every Tunisian, but also people from other countries like Morocco or Algeria, every time I start to talk about immigration and their lives, they come out with this date, 1990. Before I needed just the suitcase, and after that it started to become harder and harder. And it's something that is very common. It's not patent for us European, because we do live in this area of free movement, but for them it was a big moment, a big change. Probably, I have to go deeper in this question, even because as a historian, I'm not that comfortable with 1990s. But probably in the future, I should deal with this period as well.
Donald Tricarico asks, has there been an uptick in Sicilian business investment in Tunisia in recent decades? I'm thinking in particular about Sicilian olive oil companies.
Yes, I'm sure there has been an uptake in Sicilian business in Tunisia. I'm not aware about the role of olive oil. I do know that there is a movement. It's a movement that concerns Sicily, obviously, because we still have this connection between the island and Tunisia, but it's something that concerned the whole of Italy. People going to Tunisia to invest because of the cost of labor, because Tunisia is considered a pacified country. And yes, there is an evident increase of Italian investments in Tunisia, and even of small businesses. That's the new thing, because before there were big companies like Eni and other companies who were already there. And now we are starting to see small companies moving to Tunisia to do like an upgrade.
Caroline Waldron asks, what types of gender dynamics occurred, either demographically or in terms of work available? What are Tunisian women migrants doing in Sicily?
So that's a blind spot of my research, in the sense that I've not looked into the gender divides. What I can say is that at the beginning, the great majority of these migrants were men. They were they came to Sicily just to fish, and as often happened for migrants, the plan was to stay in Sicily just a couple of years and then come back. But then obviously, and quite fast, we started to have Tunisian families. And obviously the women were not, at least that's what I got, they were not employed in the seafaring activities in Mazara del Vallo, Sciacca or Marsala. So they were mostly, most of them worked for, as colf or helping Italian families with grandmother, this kind of thing. And that's a story that obviously deserves to be studied, because it's quite different and could enrich also the relationship between the two communities.
Victoria Sferlaza asks, I learned from Gaetano Cipolla that his book, which is a Sicilian textbook to learn Sicilian, is in use at the University of Tunisia. Can you comment on language use in Tunisia? And I'm assuming she's referring to both Italian and or Sicilian.
I mean, it's for an Italian, it's particularly interesting to arrive in Tunisia and discover that thousands and thousands of people actually do speak Italian and you don't understand why. And then you start to discover that a bit for question of historical connection, a bit because Rai broadcasted there for many, many years. Then we had like a small influence on the cuisine or other sectors. And so I was actually able, even if I speak French and I spoke French with people and a bit of Arabic, but actually when people discovered that I was Italian, they were in a hype because they wanted to try their Italian. And
Anonymous attendee asks, given the history of living in each other's countries, has there been much intermarriage?
Which further integrates the two. So there has been cases of intermarriage. I wouldn't say that's so relevant to be like to have a demographical result or to provoke like a complete fusion of the two communities. But we had cases. I don't have the numbers of Italians marrying Tunisians, Arab Tunisians in the period of, in the colonial period. I know that there are cases also in for that historical phase, especially among Italian Jews and Tunisian Jews. For the current Tunisian immigration, I see that there are intermarriages, but they are still, there is still a resistance, I would say, inside the Italian, the Sicilian communities to let, sorry for the term, to let girls marry Tunisian men. The other way around is more common, I would say. But again, I'm talking from my experience, which is not scientific, it's what I can see around me.
Angela Zagarella asks, do you know whether there are mosques in Sicily for Tunisians to practice their religion? And if not, are there any plans to build them?
There are mosques. There is a mosque in Catania. There's one in Mazara del Vallo. In Mazara del Vallo, it's like a building that was converted to become a mosque, but they are thinking about building a proper one, even because, as we said before, part of this community is now well-to-do, and so they are also eager to invest to build this mosque. And there is a mosque in Palermo, so there are mosques, yes.
And she has another question. Angela, have you looked at the role of Sicily, for example, Lampedusa, during the Arab Spring that started in Tunisia?
Now, apart from the role that I know, the role in the sense that it became like a safety valve for emigration, I don't know of roles of migrant of Tunisians opposing the regime or going against the regime in Sicily. I don't think, again, that's from the interviews that I've done. There is a division inside Tunisian in relation to the old regime. There are various ideas, various political positions that coexist inside the Tunisian community in Sicily. So they are not mobilized against this or for this.
We have another question regarding religion. I believe this is probably off track for your research, Giuliano, but Victoria Sverlaza asks, what about religious demographics in Tunisia? Are there many Christians there, churches?
So Christians, Tunisia, as I mentioned, Tunisia experienced a moment of Arabization after in the 1960s. And so at the moment of independence in 1956, there were around 300,000 Christians living in Tunisia. So we told the infrastructure, the church, and everything that was that came with that kind of presence. Obviously, then there was a huge process of Arabization, and the country became Arab, 100% Arab, even if this is, we can question. Right now, they are opening again because we have the movement, a sort of popular movement of people, of European people moving to Tunisia, but I don't see like a revival in Christianity because of this. They have this heritage, they have this legacy of beautiful churches, beautiful Christian infrastructure in Tunisia, but they are not alive.
Okay. I want to take this opportunity to thank both Giuliano and Lina for wonderful presentations, and to invite you all to return on Monday when we move from Sicily to the northeast of Italy. See you on Monday.